Greetings and welcome to worship.
I'm Rob Kopp, pastor of Bemidji United Methodist Church.
And I'm Michelle Miller. I'm the pastor of Wesley United Methodist in Crookston and Erskine and Fosston United Methodist Churches.
We are coming to you as a clergy couple today from the sanctuary at Wesley United Methodist Church in Crookston. Let us be in a spirit of worship.
Now let us join together in the call to worship. Let it be known and proclaimed. Let this truth sink into the depths of your being.
The presence of God receives us as we are.
Our questions, our pain, our stories unfinished, and memories held close.
There is a love to hold it all.
Quieting the noise of shame, casting out words of not enough.
The voice of God says, welcome, welcome, welcome. Let us join together in singing, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near and the day is past and gone, at the river I stand, guide my feet, hold my hand, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Let us join together in the opening prayer. Beloved one, your love has companioned us since birth. You know our stories, our struggles, the very root of our being. There is nothing hidden from you. Even in our greatest insecurities, you embrace and encourage us. May we be disciples of your compassion, extending to others the grace that enables us our hope. Amen.
Hear these words from the Gospel of John, the first chapter. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered, Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, Very, very truly I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Stories of holy summons today. And as you listen, I invite you to call up your stories of holy summons, perhaps to recognize them for the first time, or to dare to claim them, or to open yourself to receiving. God indeed calls to us, often through one another, just as we are. Sometimes tangibly, sometimes very subtly, God nudges, invites, announces, prods, appears in our dreams, calls us by name. As the writer of our liturgy says, God calls to us. We call out to God. We call out to each other. These spiritual journeys are not individualistic, but shared, entangled, interconnected. We cannot do this work of love on our own. We depend on God searching our hearts, make known to us what we cannot perceive on our own. We depend on invitations to come and see, to learn from the journey and experience of others. We depend on help discerning the sacred purpose of our particular lives, the calling to contribute to collective life through our unique gifts and desires. As we are summoned. As we are, imperfect, very human, and uniquely loved by God, who made us, loves us extravagantly as we are, and calls us by name. God calls us to the work of justice and grace, balanced in our interaction with God and with each other. Before the Bible stories, I start with a story of my own. 20 years ago now, minus 4 months. I was a lay leader in my church and working more broadly in the annual conference and reconciling movement for understanding and inclusion of GLBTQ people. It was Pentecost. I had just been to our annual conference session with a Holy Spirit theme as a lay delegate, and I had met there with a student at United Theological Seminary. I thought I might consider attending seminary part-time. It seemed unlikely, but I had taken the risk to talk with her more, and she invited me to call her if I wanted to visit the seminary. That Pentecost Sunday morning, 2 days later, I was sitting very gratefully in my church, in the very middle of a pew. Pentecost, as I said, with people all around me. And during the offering, some had streamers of multi-red fabric on poles, and they ran around the sanctuary and the aisles with the streamers blowing like wisps of fire as they ran. It was moving and beautiful, especially seeing spirit-filled people I knew and loved, imaging the work and call of the Holy Spirit. Lost in thought, enjoying the music and symbols, surrounded by friends, something whapped me on the side of my head. I turned to look and saw Mary fleeting away, red fabric streaming behind her. Was it a sign? What happened with the streamer? I asked Mary afterwards. It could not have been an accident. It would have been a reach, even with a stick the fabric was fastened to. I thought I could still feel that point of impact a tiny bit. Or was that imagined? Mary said lightheartedly, It just seemed like the Spirit told me to touch you. So I did. I don't know why. Just meant it to be a light tap. The Holy Spirit had something for me to do. The next Tuesday, I visited the seminary, and I began classes in September. God does call us, And lots of times it is in very human, even earthy, sometimes amusing ways. God finds ways, ways we can understand or come to understand with others' help. And God calls all kinds of people. People one might not expect, me, maybe you, to play a part in bringing about the realm of God, using our unique selves to bring about the balance of justice and grace God so desires for all God's creation. So to the first Bible story. This is the story from the first of the Old Testament readings for today. I'm just going to tell it to you. It's a story of Samuel and Eli. Samuel was a young boy. He came to be serving in the temple because of a vow his faithful mother Hannah had made, that if God allowed her to have a child, she would dedicate the child to service for God. So Samuel came to be serving and learning under Eli. One night, Samuel was lying down in the temple near the Ark of God, the large ornate container that held the signs of the presence of the Lord. As he lay there, Samuel heard a voice calling his name. So he answered, "Here I am," he said to Eli, his mentor, as someone who serves would do, assuming it was Eli who called out to him, going to see what Eli wanted. "I didn't call you. You can go lie down again," Eli said. Happened again, the voice calling Samuel's name, and Eli, not realizing that God was calling the boy. The word of the Lord was rare in that time, the scripture said. But when it happened a third time, it dawned on Eli that it was the Lord calling Samuel. "If the Lord calls again, say this, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" Samuel went back to bed, and he did hear the Lord calling, "Samuel, Samuel." "Now," Samuel says, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." And the Lord speaks to Samuel. In the next verses, we get to hear what it was that the Lord said to Samuel and what happened. Really, this part of the story sounds very much like current events. We need the work of God for justice and grace in our time, as the Hebrew people needed then. So what the Lord told Samuel had directly to do with Eli, who was the leader of the people. The Lord was going to bring about the downfall of Eli's household, as the Lord had proclaimed he would do, because Eli had failed to rein in his sons and their wrongdoing. His sons, second in command to him, had long been using the temple offerings for their own benefit. They had been raping women who came to serve and to worship. Eli, who was in charge of them and knew about what was happening, had not done enough to stop them. He didn't take responsibility. So the Lord was going to take care of the situation. Eli's household would be punished. His line of authority would not continue. Well, you can imagine Samuel's feelings the next morning. Bearing this information, he got up, not wanting to tell Eli what the Lord had said. He opened the temple doors to allow people to enter as usual, and then heard Eli calling him, "Samuel, my son." "I'm here," Samuel said. And Eli did want to know all about what the Lord had said to Samuel. Eli likely knew what the subject was, but he wanted to know all of it, insisted that Samuel tell him. And so Samuel told him. And Eli responded, "He is the Lord. He will do as he pleases." Samuel grew up. He kept knowing the presence and word of the Lord. His reputation as a trustworthy prophet grew among the people. Instead of staying in the temple, he went out among the people, listening and speaking, balancing grace with justice. Samuel was young and still learning, but open to serving, hearing, and speaking. Eli was far from perfect, but at last he realized that God was calling Samuel. And when he did, he told Samuel to respond and how, saying, "Here I am listening." And though Eli was responsible for evils, he heard and recognized the Lord's word through Samuel's telling. It's not all that easy, is it, to recognize the voice of God, especially if, like for Eli, your vision is failing and the word of the Lord has been rarely heard lately. Or maybe that's perception. Because if our God is the God of whom the psalmist writes in Psalm 139, "You have searched me and known me. You know when I rise up and when I lie down. You've created me, shaped me, known me since before birth, have plans for me, call me by name." Surely that God, always present, never distant, always loving, is by God's very nature communicating with you and me. Now, sometimes even if I do think God is speaking, I will rationalize that can't be, right? Because that's not the way things work. Maybe that's why, often enough, God's holy summons comes to us through someone we know who invites or observes or encourages. So we come now to the story of Philip and Nathanael. I just love Nathanael. Jesus has just connected with Philip, found him, and called him to follow. Philip, transformed and deeply joyful, found Nathanael and said urgently, "We have found the long-awaited Messiah, and he's from Nazareth, as Moses and the prophets said he would be." Nathanael's response: "Can anything from the backward town of Nazareth be good?" "Come and see," Philip says. Nathanael goes to see, to meet Jesus. And I think we should pause here just for a second and defend Nathanael. Mainstream theologians have criticized Nathanael for being cynical, not respectful, perhaps. It has taken female theologians, especially women of color, to look at what Nathanael does with fresh insight. So what's the matter with being skeptical, with asking questions, with owning your discouragement, with long waiting for an end to oppression? Jesus didn't seem to mind. In fact, Jesus had seen and known him and welcomed him as he was, knowing likely that Nathanael could connect with some of God's beloved people in ways more earnest, straightforward people could not. Jesus didn't say, as Nathanael approached, "Here comes that cynical guy. We should wait a while with this one till he loses his bad attitude." No. Here's what Jesus said: "Here is a genuine Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Of course, Nathanael has more questions. "How do you know me?" he asks. And Jesus replied, "Even before Philip called you, I saw you under the fig tree." At this, Nathanael, knowing himself to be both known and loved and appreciated for himself, named what he saw: that this rabbi who stood before him was God's son. And Jesus promised that Nathanael would see heaven opened and Jesus' glory. A shy but brave kid from a small town, a young boy whose mother's promise placed him in temple service, a guy who tends to question authority. Yes, God calls to us in all our humanness, has unique service for each of us to do. By God's grace, that work is tailored to our unique and very human selves. God, who has created us, has searched us and known us, has work for us each to do in bringing about God's kingdom in this particular moment. Let us open our minds and our eyes and our hearts in curiosity and humility to what God might be inviting us to do and to be. Let us open our whole selves to the Holy One who loves each one and yearns for us and points the way to justice with grace. God knows you. God sees you. God calls you by name. God says to you, come and see. Let us sing together, open my eyes that I may see.
Let us be in a spirit of prayer. It doesn't matter how far we go to run from you, God who calls us. You reach out and touch us with healing in your hands and turn us around so we can follow you home. It doesn't matter how suspicious we are of you, God who invites us to follow. You remove our fears with your compassion. You take away our doubts with complete acceptance of who we are. It doesn't matter how often we ignore your words, God who speaks to us. You whisper to us until our ears tingle with anticipation and we listen with eager hope. God in community, Holy One, continue to call us by name as we pray in silence. God in community, holy in one, continue to call us by name
even as we pray in the name of the one who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
There are parts of who we are, each of us, that have been demeaned, shamed, or silenced. Love asks us not to hide them away, but to bring them before God, to see what wisdom they might hold, what story they might tell, what gifts they might bear. In faith, let us share all of who we are and all of what we have with God and one another.
Let us join together in the prayer of dedication. Beloved one, here we are, imperfect, created good, whole and broken all at once. We bring our offerings as those who heal and harm, as those who have done violence and received care. We pray for the accountability, transformation, and wisdom that will lead us in the way of liberation, and give thanks for your assurance that for today we are enough. Amen.
Love sends us in our full humanity to encounter the full humanity of others, messy, real, complicated as it is.
That compassion may be our practice.
That differences may be our teacher.
That honesty and truth may guide us. God calls not the perfect, but the willing.
With the assurance of the Spirit's companionship, go in peace.